It's a great privilege to be here at Beyond Baroque, and Harold actually read here in 1982, I believe, with Allen Ginsberg. And these types of literary arts places are really, really important. I also want to acknowledge Jerry Cimino and the Beat Museum. The Beat Museum has been kind of presenting overall these events that have been going on for Harold's centennial. I also want to mention, in case you don't have any money left over, there's also some bookmarks. I got commemorative centennial bookmarks. They're out there in the bookstore, so grab there's a set of three, so make sure you grab some of those on your way out. I was just going to take a quick couple minutes and give you a short introduction to Harold Norse, in case there's some folks that maybe aren't very familiar with him. We are here to celebrate his centennial. Harold was born July 16th, 1916, in the Manhattan borough of Brooklyn. He was born to an unwedded, illiterate immigrant mother from Lithuania, and he had a very incredible life that we're still appreciating and understanding. He grew up, as I said, in Brooklyn, in the immigrant streets of Brooklyn. His childhood inspiration was Walt Whitman, another great gay poet, Brooklyn poet as well. And Harold really came of age in the 1930s and 40s in the Bohemian milieu of Greenwich Village. This is a time when all the queer, unknown writers were struggling to survive and get published, and Harold was amongst them. His good friends, James Baldwin, Tennessee Williams, was involved at the founding of the Living Theaters, Richard Modiano mentioned. He was also mentored by older generation of writers, like Anais Nin, Dylan Thomas, and he had a very great life at that time. But in the 1950s, with the Cold War, McCarthyism, the conservatism became very difficult for Harold, particularly their attacks against poets, against homosexuals, and in 1953 he left the country for 15 years, first traveling to Italy where he spent 5 years, established a correspondence with the American poet William Carlos Williams, who encouraged Harold to move away from modernist poetry and to embrace what Williams called the American idiom. And that's essentially returning to the streets of the language of the streets, the immigrants, the working class, the uneducated, which Harold, of course, was trying to move away from by going to college and working on his PhD. He wanted to get away from that. And Williams helped him discover the poetry and the beauty in that. And it really opened up Harold's mature poetic voice, I would say, which was a mixture of the contemporary and the classical, because Harold was not only a poet, but he was also a scholar. From Italy, he traveled to Paris and stayed at the Beat Hotel in the early 1960s with William Burroughs, Gregor Corso, and Brian Gysin, developing the cut-up method of literature, where they're actually cutting up text and rearranging them. From there, he traveled to the Greek islands in the mid-60s, where he mentored a unknown Canadian folk singer by the name of Leonard Cohen, until he repatriated in the summer of 68 to here in Venice Beach, where he lived for a few years, before making San Francisco his home, where he lived for the remainder of his life. He moved there in the early 70s, where he wrote a lot of really beautiful, brilliant poetry documenting the city's gay liberation movement. I come into this story here in the last 10 years of Harold's life. I was an activist with ACT UP San Francisco, an AIDS activist in San Francisco, and I was introduced to Harold by my friend, the Chicano surrealist poet Ronnie Burke. And I, along with my brother Tate, knew Harold for the last 10 years of his life. Since his death in 2009, I gathered Harold's papers, his archives, which are now at the Bacoff Library at UC Berkeley. And since then, have been working to get all his books back into print. They're all out of print. That's why Richard said collector's items. That's why some of these books are kind of pricey, because they are themselves artifacts. So this centennial, been working on it for a while, got kicked off in June when I went to Manchester, England to participate in the European Beat Studies Network. They had their annual conference in Manchester, and I gave a presentation on Harold's kind of work at the Beat Hotel there. I'm pleased to say that there are a lot of scholars familiar with Harold's work and interested in. Also, a lot of young students, college students, graduate students, that are aware of Harold and very interested. And I had conversations with students from Spain to Italy to Denmark, and I know Harold would have been very pleased to hear that, and he probably would have made some passes at some of the good-looking young men as well. We did two events in San Francisco, one at the Mechanics Institute on Harold's birthday, with the San Francisco poet Kevin Killian and the writer Regina Marler, who edited the anthology Queer Beats. And then 2 weeks ago, Tate and I were in North Beach at the Beat Museum with the gay poet Jim Rivaki and the writer and actor Adrian Brooks, who was involved with the Angels of Light, the theatrical troupe that came out in San Francisco after the Conquets. Each event has been getting better and better, and I'm really excited about tonight. So I want to thank each of you for coming out tonight to join us for something that's really special and magical. So we're going to kick it off with a little bit of a poetic invocation, here. And I'm very excited and pleased to have with us here a local artist by the name of Jason Jen, who's a multimedia performing artist and writer based out of Los Angeles with strong roots in rural Iowa. In recent years, he has brought his own queer spirit to interpret and stage the works of poet Constantine P. Gavafi, James Broughton, who's a poet and filmmaker from San Francisco, who's a very good friend of Harold's, Paul Monette, and is excited for the experience of working with Harold Norse. And we're excited to have Jason bringing his spirit here with us. You can find out more about Jason at jasonjen.com.
Thank you. I realized I didn't get some water earlier, so I'm going to pour some now. But I will say it is such a pleasure to be here and to have been able to go to the celebrations in San Francisco for Harold. I met Todd and Tate a year ago when they were promoting the I Am Going to Fly Through Glass book, and I really loved what was read for Harold. So basically, wanted to present a selection of his poems for you and give a dramatic interpretation today. All my life I've been waiting. All my life I've been waiting for something unusual to happen. I may yet come into a windfall, national endowment of the hearts. All my life I've been expecting a grand finale, an awakening, love erupting in the streets, in the bars, in classrooms, everyone dropping their guard, their pants, their skirts. Cops weeping tenderly as they snap off your cuffs. Bankers giving away their money. Politicians telling the truth. Literary critics confessing they know nothing about writing or life. All my life I've been waiting for something unusual to happen. I'm not a man. I'm not a man. I can't earn a living, buy new things for my family. I have acne and a small Peter. I'm not a man. I don't like football, boxing, and cars. I like to express myself. I even like to put an arm around a friend's shoulder. I'm not a man. I won't play the role assigned to me. The role created by Madison Avenue, Playboy, Hollywood, and Oliver Cromwell. TV does not dictate my behavior. I'm not a man. Once when I shot a squirrel, I swore I would never kill again. I gave up meat. The sight of blood makes me sick. I like flowers. I'm not a man. I went to prison resisting the draft. I do not fight back when real men beat me up and call me queer. I dislike violence. I'm not a man. I have never raped a woman. I don't hate blacks. I don't get emotional when the flag is waved. I do not think I should love America or leave it. I think I should laugh at it. I'm not a man. I have never had the clap. I'm not a man. Playboy is not my favorite magazine. I'm not a man. I do not feel superior to women. I'm not a man. I don't wear a jockstrap. I'm not a man. I write poetry. I'm not a man. I meditate on peace and love. I'm not a man. I don't want to destroy you. So Todd asked, as well as doing a few of those poems, to do one specifically that he wrote while he was living here in Venice Beach. And I thought it would be nice to use a little bit of music to accompany it that was from the era he lived here, from 69 to 71. And I figured this poem is kind of a hallucinatory, trippy, dreamlike vision, and that the music from the soundtrack Beyond the Valley of the Dolls might go really well.
The greatest films of all time.
And I figured Harold would have seen that, you know, while he was here. So here we go. California will sink. I woke up and looked around. Same old curtainless windows, torn shades through which the sun easily broke mornings. Roaches rocked in brown paper sacks of garbage, and the pink fridge held its hopeful vitamins that would save me from the smog and food conspiracy. And the dawn crept across the windowsill like a sick bum. And I thought, all this will change. All this will change. And dressed and shaved and went down to the beach and ran along the shore, nodding to the yogis in the lotus position, contemplating their acid navels. The sun could not rise without their help. And returned to lunch and napped in the afternoon. When I awoke, it was evening. I went down to the beach and the whales were dying on the shore and the sea lions perishing and the fish uneatable and the gulls choked with oil and the plants withered and the air brown, and the people irrelevant. Victims of enterprise, denied, denied, denied by the politicians, the industrialists. And there was nothing I could do but wait for the prophecy to be fulfilled. California will sink, overloaded with deadliness, into the Pacific. mean, what is the coastline now of many a land will be the bed of the ocean. The oceans are dying. They are not dying of long hair and nudity, but the people cannot understand. They cannot draw sane conclusions. The people are sick. They have been too long poisoned by lies, by flags, by slogans, by counterfeit nourishment. They do not know. They do not see. They are with the gall and the sagebrush, the ocean and the spider, the sky and the dove. And now for a little musical change. The next selection are a trio of poems that Harold wrote, not love poems, but on the theme of love. And for that we have some classical symphony by Haydn. I would not recommend love. My head felt stabbed by a crown of thorns. But I joked and rode the subway and ducked into School John's and rode the subway and secretly wrote of teenage hell. Because I was different, the first and last of my kind, smothering acute sensations in swimming pools and locker rooms, addict of lips and genitals, mad for buttocks, that Whitman and Lorca and Catullus and Marlowe and Michelangelo and Socrates admired. And I wrote, friends, if you wish to survive, I would not recommend love. I would not recommend love. I would not recommend love. We do not speak of love. We do not speak of love, but all are pushed and pulled by it, taking all forms and shapes, twisted, pounded, burnt by it. Like the sculptor's clay, our faces are punched and pinched, drawn long and ripped apart by it. Eyes pained or deep or lost, lines cut in cheeks and forehead from it. We do not speak of love, our faces scream of it. Haunting bars and running wild in the streets for it. We do not speak of love, but spike warm veins, pop pills, burst brain with alcohol for it. Gods and demons wrestle the heart of it. I cannot survive the lack of it. The gift of love. Consider the importance now of love. The darkened room, the body's charm, healing what words have bruised, the sympathy beneath our feelings. Consider the importance now of touch that soothes the ego's rampage, apostasy of friends turned foes. We linger in the present moment away from words that wound and kill, and find the world made new again. We linger in the present moment, away from words that wound and kill, and find the world made new again. As we accept the gift of love, most desired, most dear, and most abused, the gift of love. Let go and feel your nakedness. Let go and feel your nakedness. Tits ache to be bitten and sucked. Let go with smell of armpit and crotch. Let go with hole a tingle. Let go with tongue lapping hairy cunt. Lick feet, kiss ass, suck cock and balls. Let the whole body go. Let love come through, let freedom ring. Let the whole body go. Let love come through, let freedom ring. Let the whole body go. Let love come through, let freedom ring. Let go with moans and erogenous zones. Let go with heart and soul. Let go the dead meat of convention. Wake up the live meat of love. Let go with sense, pull out the stops, forget false teachings and lies. Let go of inherited belief. Let go of guilt and shame, in brief. Let go of phantom worries, choked back in muscle and nerve. Let go of rigid rules and roles. Let go of uptight poses. Let go of your puppet self. Let go and renew yourself and be free. Let go the dead meat of convention. Wake up the live meat of love. Let go this moment, this hour, this day. Tomorrow will be too late. Let go of guilt and frustration. Let liberation and tolerance flow. Let go of phantom worries and fears. Let go of hours and days and years. Let go of rage and hate and grief. Let walls against ecstasy fall for relief. Let go of pride and greed. Let go of missiles and might and creed. Let go the dead meat of convention. Wake up the live meat of love. Wake up! Wake up! Wake up! Wake up! Wake up the live meat of love! Happy birthday, Harold, from that speech.
That Jason read, really, that was really great with the music too. That was, as he said, written here in Venice Beach. Harold lived here until about 1971, and he came back to America for a lot of reasons. He had hepatitis. He'd been abroad for a long time. The main reason he came to Venice was because his mother was living here, out on Paloma Avenue, in a big brick building that's actually still there. You can see it. And he wrote a number of poems. He was, this is when I should probably plug Harold's memoirs. They're called Memoirs of a Bastard Angel. You can find it very cheap online. Should be in your local library. But he talks a bit about that time. He was in his 50s, and he came back to America and was really excited to see how things had changed youth culture very much. And he started getting himself healthy again. He started bodybuilding. He was lifting weights with Arnold Schwarzenegger at Gold's Gym, and wrote some poems out on Muscles Beach. And that's when he became very good friends with poet Neely Tchaikovsky. And so that's when he finally met Charles Bukowski, who had been Harold had been a mentor for Bukowski for a number of years. They had been corresponding. So there's a lot of very direct personal history for Harold here in Venice Beach. So it's a great, great privilege and joy to be bringing his queer spirit back here. So we are going to continue on. I'm going to introduce our next speaker, who is S.A. Griffin, lives, loves, and works in Los Angeles. He is the progenitor of Elsie, the poetry bomb, which he took on a 5-week tour of the United States in 2010 in an effort to foster civil disagreements. The co-editor of the Outlaw Bible of American Poetry, which Harold was very prominently featured in, and I should also mention as a side, there is a new edition out, just came out, called The Outlaw Bible of American Art, which features an essay by Tate Nye on Harold's paintings they're called cosmographs. He made these really psychedelic paintings and lived at the Beat Hotel. But anyway, S.A. was the co-editor of the Outlaw Bible of American Poetry. He recently edited The Official Language of Yes by Scott Weinberg for Percival Press, and National Geographics by M. Lane Brunner, published on his own Rose of Sharon imprint. His latest collection of verse, Dreams Gone Mad with Hope, was released in 2014 by Punk Hostess Press. I've read it, it's an excellent book, I highly recommend it, and I'm sure there's probably copies available here in the bookstore. So it's a great privilege to welcome S.A. Griffin.
Thank you, dog. And you'll be tested later. I'm honored to be here, thank you very much, sir. On the anniversary of Stonewall, in the aftermath of Orlando, the advent of Trump, and on the cusp of Clinton, and on Harold's 100th birthday, I'm honored to be here. So what I've done is, to honor Harold, I've done a cut and paste, and it's real. The only things that were concrete were the first line and the last line. You've heard some of this already just now. And I literally just went in, I just pasted the stuff in the pages, and then I just moved stuff around. I only moved one line because it begged to be moved. But aside from that one line, the first line, the last line, it's actually a real cut and paste for Harold on his 100th birthday. I am not a man. I write poetry. We dig up ancient shards, clicking cameras among the dying cypresses choked by Athenian smog. Let go this moment, this hour, this day. Tomorrow will be too late. I am not a man. I can't earn a living, buy new things for my family. I have acne and a small peter. Yet cats continue basking in the hazy sun. The chain goat sways in ecstasy. I am not a man. I don't like football, boxing, and cars. I like to express my feelings. I even like to put my arm around my friend's shoulder. A young man making music and love to a girl whose interest in love and music coincides with an enormous despair in both. Flow of unthinking flesh, frank thighs, eyes of Aphrodite. Let go of guilt and frustration. Let liberation and tolerance flow. Will the golden age ever come? Same faces throw up each generation, same races, emotions, struggles, all those centuries, those countries, languages, songs, discontents. Let go of phantom worries and fears. Let go of hours and days and years. I am not a man. I won't play the role assigned to me, the role created by Madison Avenue, Playboy, Hollywood, and Oliver Cromwell. Television does not dictate my behavior. Bring back the carnivorous saint whose mother is no virgin. She is Our Lady of Peace movements to ban the bomb and clean up the air. She'll wave her umbrella and change the world.
We need the Antichrist who is probably playing football around the corner. The sweet boy who used to be called Eros and wants us to be happy, enclosed in a soundproof room. Low, rapid monologue, nervous whisper of junk journey, endless trips. They return here in San Francisco as I sit in the Café Trioste. I am not a man. I have never had to clap. Let the age hang itself. We've had four marvelous days together. No news reports, only music and no serious discussions. Let go of hate and rage and grief. Let walls fall against ecstasy. Ecstasy fall for relief. Blue dream of space. Celestial flash of blue light and crystal blue silence. On blue mosaic floors. Lattice light on silent mosaic heads. Oh, recitative of years. Oh, Paradiso sings the jukebox as Virgil and Verdi combine in this life to show this is the only golden age there'll ever be. Their inner selves like a plucked guitar in the dry hot sun of hope, where savage and brutal men are tearing light like a page from a very ancient and yellow book. I am not a man. I went to prison for resisting the draft. I do not fight when real men beat me up and call me queer. I dislike violence. The Parthenon looks down from creamy heights. Lichen and rust nibble the pediments, and tourist feet break the spell of antiquity's vibrations. Too stone to move, 3 years in the Casbah, empty palace, mosaic walls, 6 kids, rush mats, a cat, a groundhog. Nah, I forgot, somebody ate the groundhog, made groundhog soup. We may not live very well or long. Our mistakes are perhaps too great to bear correction at this midpoint of our lives. Aladdin's a joint machine, sits and rolls till he's catatonic. A holy roller, shit is his religion. Best dealer in Tangier, you always get a good count. Eh, così, that's how it goes. Old worlds burn down and new worlds form in clouds of brown monoxide morning. I am not a man. I have never raped a woman. I don't hate blacks. I don't get emotional when the flag's waved. I do not think I should love America or leave it. I think I should laugh at it. Walking through incendiary alleys of crowded laundry with yellow gourds and windows and crumbling masonry of wars. Human corruption so thick and hopeless that I laugh. They're living in the universe, man. No gas, no water, no electricity. Only the blinding light of the void in Hotel Universe. Hotel Nirvana. Let go the dead meat of convention. Wake up the live meat of love. I am not a man. Playboy is not my favorite magazine. But I saw Hermes in the rainbow, the dark oil on the floor reflected there, and the wild hair of the Sibyl as her words bubbled mad and drowned beneath the motor's roar. I am not a man. I cry when I'm unhappy. I am not a man. I do not feel superior to women. I am not a man. I don't wear a jockstrap. Man, all they ever eat is brownies. Mahjong brownies, hash, honey, sesame seeds, anise, dates, cinnamon. Check runs out each month. The bread goes for hash and grass. Even the kids are stoned. Contact high. They were conceived high. I am not a man. Once when I shot a squirrel, I swore that I would never kill again. I gave up meat, the sight of blood, makes me sick. I was walking through the city past umber indices and pine-lined palaces, fat palms beside balconies. The heat's something you could really touch. The kids with cunning delinquent faces after Americana sailors. I like flowers. I'm not a man. I meditate on peace and love. The grass hits as I look at rusty orange-eyed caps, thinking, who needs nuclear Apollo? Thermonuclear Minerva? Nike crashing to grand finale? When suddenly, I saw among the oil and greasy rags and wheels and axles of a garage the carved new figures of a classic frieze, there, above the dismantled parts of cars. Among dead heroes and gods, I'm not a man. I don't want to destroy you. Let go of pride and greed. Let go of missiles and might and creed. Remember this, the wine, the ladder of stars that climb, Vesuvius outside my window. A youth emerged from the crowd, barefoot and olive-skinned, and we climbed up rocky slopes till dusk fell, and close to the moon at the mouth of a cave, we made love as the sea broke wild beneath the cliff, as we lay together carrying a burnished Christ. Remember, remember, the end is the beginning.
Wonderful, real tribute. Harold would have loved that too. Kind of, as I said, Harold lived.
James, nothing wrong with that.
Well, no, it's also great to see everybody bring their different interpretations, you know, to this work, because I think one of the reasons that Harold's work lives on is because it's true, it's valid, it's accessible. There is definitely a lot of different entry points into it. As I said, Harold lived in the early 60s at the Beat Hotel in Paris, and so the cut-up theory, what they did is they actually like physically cut up text and would lay and rearrange it like a jigsaw puzzle. And for Harold's experience, it was something to break through the linear thinking through the rational mind, connecting back with Tristan Tzara, Arthur Rimbaud, the derangement of the senses. So we got a little cut up there of Harold's travels. There's some Naples going on there, Athens. I forgot to mention, there's so many things to talk about with Harold. Tangier. Harold lived in Tangier for quite some time. He actually inhabited the room that William Burroughs had been in when Burroughs was composing Naked Lunch. And he took a young Moroccan lover named Mohammed. And there's a bit to sniffing keyholes in there. So that was really fabulous. Also, the last line you had there, the end is the beginning. That was actually Harold's last known words. It almost sounds too perfect for a poet, but the last 2 years of his life, he lived in Hayes Valley Care, in an assisted care facility. Before that, he'd been around the city a bit. For a number of decades, he lived in a cottage in the Mission District off Albion Street, tucked in the back. And as an aside, there's been a lot of... Harold worked very much on the cosmic plane. And there's been a lot of connections coming out lately, I think because of his 100th birthday. One of which was after the reading 2 weeks ago in the Beat Museum, I got back, I was staying in the Tchaikovsky's place, and Jerry Semino from the Beat Museum had forwarded me an email. Turns out that there are these two gay guys, married gay guys, Irish and English, and they're living in what had been the basement of Harold's old cottage. And they just found out about the centenary and couldn't make any of the events, but I've actually started kind of corresponding with them. And so these connections are really kind of coming back and bringing it, making it new into something new. But Harold's last couple of years were very pleasant for him. He had really good friends and really good company. And so there was a nurse or assistant there who checked on him about 2:30 in the morning, the last day of his life. And the words that she heard him say were, "The end is the beginning." Is Michael C. Ford here?
I don't see him.
No? Okay. Well, then we're going to continue on. So I guess then it'll be a good time. So I'll introduce, I'm going to introduce, our next speaker is going to be my brother Tate, my kind of co-conspirator, collaborator on this stuff with Harold. I do want to mention that Tate, amongst other things, he's a poet and a filmmaker and a painter, and he also runs a record label called Unrequited Records. And what he's been doing, amongst other things, has been releasing spoken word records. The first one is called Harold Norse, of course, And what it is a reading that Harold gave in Amsterdam in 1984. It was originally put out by Harold's good friend and our good friend, Eddie Woods, who ran In and Out Press. Eddie put it out on cassette. And Tate went and released it on, it's a digital download you can get through the website, and also a stunningly beautiful album. It's a double album, colored vinyl, gatefold. There's copies there. I know a lot of you might not have a record player, but trust me, go and take a look, open it up, and flip through it, and just look at it like as an object. It's a very, very beautiful thing. And it's a great reading by Harold. He reads a lot of his poems from Tangier there. He read Sneaking Keyholes from the Hotel. Tate's also released recordings in conjunction with Eddie. Herbert Hunke, I don't know if people are familiar with Herbert Hunke, a prose writer from one of the beat writers. He was actually the man that came up with the word beat and gave it to Jack Kerouac. He's an incredibly gifted writer. He writes beautiful prose pieces. They're kind of like impressionistic short stories about his travels and people that he knows. There's a CD there of Hunky's reading in Amsterdam in 1984. And then also, he's done some work on the poet Jack Micheline. I was born in New York City, but lived in San Francisco. They call him a street poet, they call him whatever, but he's a really great guy. He's a really brilliant poet. He's a people's poet. And there's two recordings there. Again, another Amsterdam recording by Jack, and then another one called Give America a Break that Tate did, which is one record album is Jack reading, and then the other one is people that knew Jack or were inspired by Jack talking about him or reading his books, reading his works. Again, that's on vinyl, CD, and also on digital download, unrecordedrecords.com. His next release, which is coming out in a couple months, I'm very excited about, A Man of Letters. It's for my friend Ronnie Burke. It's another similar format where it's Ronnie and then people who knew Ronnie speaking about him. So there's a lot of more stuff to come and behold. So, come on up, Tate. Thanks everyone for being here. Thank you Richard and Beyond Baroque for having us. It's great to be here celebrating Harold's 100th. I'm going to read a poem that James Broughton wrote for Harold. it's called Happy Birthday Harold for Harold Norse by James Broughton. Hello Harold, here and there. Hello Harold, everywhere. Harold in Italy, Harold in Holland, Harold in Tangier, Harold in hell. Everywhere that I have been, Harold was already in. Harold is a Norse of wandering force, prankish of nature and intercourse. Norse is a heralding widespread source of salty lust and sweet remorse. Harold in Paris, Harold in Sonoma, Harold in euphoria, Harold in the dumps. Everywhere that I have spotted, Harold has already squatted. Hello, Harold, near and far. Hello, Harold. Here you are. It's written on the 6th of July, 1986, in San Francisco. Thank you. So our final speaker is Thomas Livingston, who's published two novels, Paper Walls and The Tower Is Down, and short stories in max circulation magazines, including Playboy, literary magazines such as Nothing Doing in London, The Ledge, Bastard Angel, and Main Street Rag, and academic anthologies such as Alienation, a casebook. His poetry has appeared in two cities, The Ledge and The New Renaissance. He taught at Rutgers University and San Jose State University, and recently finished his novel, The Years of Light and Gamery. He was a very dear friend to Harold Norse. He's a very dear friend of mine. And it's with great pleasure that I bring up Tom Williams.
Before I begin, I want to just say that I found some photos of Harold's 58th birthday. It was when a little early celebration when Bastard Angel 3 had been published. And it was great. And who you're going to see is Ferlinghetti, Allen Ginsberg, his father Louis Ginsberg, and his father's second wife, Edith. And Louis Ginsberg was one of the most fabulous guys I've ever met. He loved to pun. And he was the worst punner I've ever heard. And he would have puns like, his second wife's name was Edith, and he'd have puns like, well, I'm so happy I married Edith because now I can have my cake and eat it too. But anyway, I guess why I say that you're all welcome to come up and take a look at some of these photos of Harold, and he's cutting the cake, which has the ink drawing that Peter LeBlanc had done. LeBlanc did this whole series on the beatniks, and they were published at the beginning of the issue of Bastard Angel 3. Before I begin, I'd like to thank our daughter, Tracy, for flying down from Portland to drive us here. And it's fitting that Tracy is here, because at the age of 8 and 9, she was a leading lady in many of Harold Norse's theatrical productions that took place at our dinner table. There were impromptu dramas created, directed, and produced by Harold during his frequent visits. And Howard was probably there in a couple of these. But anyway, as we ate, we had this gallon jug of Gallo-Hardy Burgundy, which is about what we could afford in those days. And as the level of the wine in the jug went down, the surrealistic level of the productions, the dramas, went up. And we often ended at levels of surrealistic brilliance that would have pleased Salvador Dali. By that time, the bottle was empty. Okay, on with the program. How many of you are in this room tonight are expert cocksuckers? I asked only because I had never heard the term expert cocksucker until I met Harold Norse. We were hanging out in Paris one afternoon complaining about how stupid New York editors were because they hadn't recognized our brilliance yet. And I was complaining because an editor at Simon & Schuster had just rejected my second novel because he pontificated, "It is seldom, if ever, that a gangster can direct the activities of his gang from when he is in prison." This was when Vito Genovese was running the Genovese family from prison and ordering the murder of rival gang leaders. "God, Harold," I said, "the editor's name is Merrill Pollack. What a snotty name. I bet he went to Princeton. So I'd like to smash the lousy cocksucker in his Ivy League nose." "But wait, Tommy, mon chou. Hold up. You can call him lousy, and you can smash his face, but never call him a cocksucker. Cocksucker is a compliment." You don't want to compliment an asshole like that. Cocksucking is an art. You don't just become an expert cocksucker overnight. First, you must be an interim cocksucker. If you show promise, you may become an apprentice cocksucker. If you show real skill, you may be promoted to associate cocksucker. And finally, after years of experience, you may be awarded the title of expert cocksucker, the dream of all cocksuckers." "Wow, Harold, I never dreamed cocksucking was so complicated." He looked at me for a moment and started to laugh. And Harold's laugh, it came from the gut. "It's not," he says. "I was just teaching you a lesson. In truth, expert cocksuckers are born, not made." It was a trait that got him through the many tough times in his life, times of the book, ravaging physical ills, and savage artistic rejection, until his later years, when his brilliance as a poet and the arc of his work began, but just began, to give him the recognition he so deserved. And now, through the dedication of Todd and Tate Swindell, Harold's reputation and recognition is at an all-time high, and that's why we're here tonight. Do you think I can get a glass of water?
Sure. Okay.
Thank you. In 1961, I was living in Palo Alto, and had just gotten the news that my first novel had been accepted by Bam Books, who was going to try it. Thank you. Who was going to try to sell it first as a hardcover house before publishing it themselves. This was a new business strategy. If the hardcover edition sold well, Bam would not have to pay a lot of money for the reprint rights because they already owned them. More money for Bam, less money for the writer. Capitalism at its Stars and Stripes best. In those pre-Silicon Valley days, Palo Alto was a small town hosting the beginnings of the nationwide drug scene. It was a small country street named Perry Lane where the poets and novelists hung out. Ken Kesey lived there and was finishing One Flew Over the Cuckoo's Nest. Tom Gunn, the English poet, was a teaching assistant at Stanford. And Peter Kump, who later became a famous chef, was producing plays downtown. It was a cool place to live, and most of us kind of hung out together, including a guy named Mike Miller. I don't know what he did, but he was a quiet, serious guy, and everyone liked him. I had decided that I'd use my advance money to go to Tahiti or Paris, and Michael was there when I flipped the coin. Heads Paris, tails Tahiti. It came up Paris. "When are you going?" he asked. I said, "Probably in about a month when I get the money." "I'm going to be there," he said. "Leave a message for me at American Express. That's where everyone picks up their mail." So when I got to Paris, I hooked up with Michael through American Express, and we went to have a drink at Harry's New York bar. And Michael then took me to meet his friend from New York, Anatole Brouillard, a book reviewer for the New York Times who was on vacation in Paris. "You guys should meet Harold Norse," he said. "I'll set it up for you. He was a good friend from our New York days." "Who's Harold Norse?" I asked. "A really gifted, expatriate American poet. He's a protege of William Carlos Williams, and he's just published an incredible translation of Giuseppe Belli's sonnets. And he's tight with Aeneas Min." I nodded wisely, but I knew I was in way over my head. I'd never heard of Belli until say nothing of his sonnets. But I knew something of Aeneas Min. I made a mental note of it. And that's how I met Harold Norse. He suggested Les Deux Magots, and when Mike and I got there, he was friendly, really down to earth, and asked us if we'd like to work as grips for the Living Theater, which was America's entry into the French Theater of Nations, a summer-long series of plays in which seven countries were invited to put on a play for an entire week, or several plays. The Living Theater had been founded by Harold's good friends, Judith Molina and Julian Beck. And that year they were putting on Jack Gelder's The Connection, which was a first play about heroin addiction that used real heroin addicts as the actors, and Brecht's In the Jungle of Cities. Michael Miller was headed for London, but I jumped at the chance to work with the Living Theater. And the magic name of Harold Norse granted me instant access to the theater and a quick interview with Judith Molina, who okayed me and sent me to the director of lighting, who took me under his wing and taught me what a grip did. The Connection played the first few days, had great reviews, and everything went well. But In the Jungle of Cities, which played the last 3 days of the week, we ran into problems. The play included a parade, and the plan was to use the actors from The Connection I said, people in the parade. Judith Molina told me to go round them up. I couldn't find anyone until I finally got to the John. And there they all were, totally strung out on heroin or in the process of shooting up. This was a really tough-looking crew, a lot of them were ex-cons. And when I timidly reminded them that they had to get ready for the parade, one guy who just slid down from the toilet to the floor shooting up snarled, "Get the fuck out of here, you honky motherfucker!" Analyzing the tone of his voice and the look in his eyes, I determined it was in my immediate interest to follow his advice. I brought the news back to Judith Molina and Julian Beck, and they were not thrilled to hear none of the actors in the parade were able to walk. After a loud and prolonged hysterical scene where they decided to cancel the play, they turned around and produced it without the parade. Harold had given me his address at 9 Rue Gilles-Lecour, which I don't think at that time was called the Beat Hotel, and told me to drop by and tell him how the Living Theater experience had worked out. Only drop by after 4 p.m., he cautioned. So about a week later, I dropped by, and there didn't seem to be any concierge, so I walked up to the room number he'd given me. The door was open. Harold was at his table at the far side of the room, working, his back to me. I rapped lightly on the door. He turned and looked at me blankly, and I realized he was trying to remember who I was. "Tom Livingston, you got me a job at the Living Theater." He nodded without much enthusiasm, and I was thinking maybe it was time to leave, when he crossed the room, grabbed a chair, and put it in the middle of the room, facing his table. So my back was to the open door. "So how did it go?" he asked kind of grumpily. I figured I'd better play my key card quick. "I understand you know Annis Lynn," I said. "You know her?" he asked in disbelief. "No, but I used to play ping pong with Henry Miller and his kids Tony and Val." This was true, and as I'm sure most of you know, Henry Miller and Annis Lynn had a long love affair. It was true, when I was writing my first novel, I was working as a chambermaid and bartender at a place in the Big Sur called Slate's Hot Springs, which later became the Esalen Institute. And someone introduced me to Henry Miller, and we used to go up there. They were great ping pong players. And then his wife, Eve, would make these fabulous spaghetti dinners. And there was a big jug of wine and garlic bread. And Miller used to go on and talk, and you know, he was an incredibly brilliant guy. So I did know him, and I did know about the affair with Annie Sin. Knowing Henry Miller made me a person of interest now, instead of just some kid writer from California. And Harold began telling me how a New York friend named Harry Hershkovitz had entrusted him with two boxes of about 500 letters from Henry Miller, and how the boxes had mysteriously disappeared. Abruptly, as he was telling me this, his voice trailed off. And just as abruptly, I felt this paralyzing chill run from the back of my neck to the bottom of my spine. "Kibble is giving you his death ray," Harold said offhandedly. I turned, and in the doorway stood a tall, pale-faced man in a three-piece suit, staring down at me, one hand holding an unopened umbrella. My introduction to William Burroughs, who turned away and called in a loud voice, "Ian, Ian, it's time for dinner." Ian was his lover. From time to time after that, I would run into Burroughs in the hallway or waiting for his lover, Ian Somerville, at the entrance of 9 Rue Gilles-Lecour. At most, he graced me with a nod, but he never spoke to me, and thank God that he never subjected me to another death ray. Harold and Burroughs could not have been more different personalities, and I think their friendship was based more on artistic respect than the warmth of camaraderie. Harold was a warm human being, a touch paranoid, easily hurt, totally dedicated to his work, enthusiastic, and with a great sense of humor. Burr's me was just scary. And he certainly wasn't warm and fuzzy. Although Harold did tell me in a humanizing story about Burroughs, Life magazine had put out this huge spread on the Beats, Henry Luce at his capitalistic best. The headline on the story was, "The Beats mount the only rebellion around, but they shabbily bungle their job in arguing, sulking, and bad poetry." When the article got to Burroughs, it defined him as William S. Burroughs, heir to the Burroughs adding machine fortune, a crazed, drug-addicted homosexual who killed his wife and writes pornographic gibberish. But anyway, when Harold saw it, I mean, this is, you know, any publicity is good publicity, as they say, and he goes running up to Burroughs, and he said, Bill, have you seen this incredible article? You're famous, Bill, and all the Beats now are famous. And Burroughs looked at him and he said, "That's all very well and good, Harold. But what am I going to tell my mother?" I saw Harold a few more times that summer, but he was too, he was getting ready to go to Tangiers, and I was finding Paris too expensive. Spain was cheap, and I decided to go to Ibiza. And I didn't see Harold again until the autumn of 1962, when we both returned to Paris. It was in that time period, after our return, that Harold's friendship with Christine and me really blossomed. He hit off big time with Christine because they had both experienced similar childhoods. And whenever he or she complained about something, he'd stop and say, "You see, it's my or your childhood script. These scripts are written for us by events we can't control when we're young, and they constantly come back to haunt us." And of course, it didn't hurt that she prepared great dinners with beautiful French produce, chicken, fish, and of course, several bottles of wine. Hanging out with Harold was like studying Western civilization in graduate school without the arrogant teachers and all the graduate school bullshit. With your own private tutor, who was the brightest guy in the school. His knowledge was encyclopedic, and every writer he turned me on to was exciting and had a fascinating backstory, which Harold always knew. Gerard de Nerval, André Breton, Louis Aragon, Paul Éluard, Louis Ferdinand Céline, and it wasn't just the writers. He knew everything about the artists, the musicians, the sculptors, sometimes even the politicians. And to each he brought not only knowledge, but this fantastic enthusiasm that made you want to stop the conversation, run out, get these books, and read them all. So went the fall of 1962 and the winter and spring of 63. We became very close friends. During that time, I'd won a fellowship to the Michael Caraway Foundation in Vence, France, a beautiful mountain village between Cannes and Nice, where Matisse created the stained glass windows and tiles for La Chapelle de Rosaire. The fellowship carried a prize of 3 months, June, July, and August, rent-free, in a cabin on a wooden hill that overlooked the Domaine Renoir. The cabin had 2 rooms, with a kitchen and bathroom in between the 2 rooms, and a deck that ran the length of the cabin. Above, at the top of the hill, was a manse, where the Countess Catherine Caraway, the widow of Count Michael Caraway, the ex-president of the First Hungarian Republic, lived. A few days after my arrival, the Countess left for a 3 to 4 week vacation in Italy. Bantam had turned down my second novel, but it agreed to pay me in advance to rewrite it, and my goal was to finish the rewrite by the time the 3 months were up. Living in the other room in the cabin was Alfred Monde, an American author and his wife, who were in their early 40s. I don't have anything to write, he admitted. I published a novel about 4 months ago, and the creative well is dry. Instead of writing, he and his wife decided to clear the land going up to the Mons. So the cabin was down here, the Mons was here, and there were just these huge weeds and grasses and bushes and things. And they started to clear it, and as they cleared it, you suddenly realized this place was beautifully terraced with stone walls that kept going up. And I thought, boy, the countess is going to be really overjoyed to see how they've improved the landscape. A few nights later, I saw the lights were on in the Mons. She had returned from Italy. The next morning, as I was typing away, she knocked on my door. She did not look happy. How's your book coming? Really well, Countess, I'm on schedule. And have you been involved in this? She said, pointing coldly toward the newly terraced landscape. No, I'm sorry, I've been too busy writing. And your cabin mates, they've done a beautiful job, don't you think? They are here to create, she shouted, not to garden. And he has created nothing. And she walked out, slamming the door. About 10 minutes later, there was a knock on the other door from the kitchen. The one, and Alfred just stuck his head in. I came to say goodbye, he said. We've been kicked out. We have to be out of here by the end of the day. During this time, Harold and I had been writing, and Harold wrote that he was on his way to Athens, going to leave shortly from Paris. And all of a sudden, I thought, my God, this is an empty room here. And I'm sure Harold and the Countess would get along. And so I went, I wrote Harold, and I said, hey, would you like to come down and spend a couple of weeks in this great cabin overlooking the Domaine de Noir? And he said, sure, can you arrange it? So I went to the Countess, and I said, you know, Harold knew Auden. He was a close friend of Auden. And she said, oh, Whiston, yes, I know Whiston well. Oh, that would be charming if he would come. Is Harold a homosexual? And I said, yeah, I guess so, could be. She said, well, he is welcome, but there is to be no hanky-panky. So I said, okay. So Harold came down, and we really had a great time. And I was pretty much finished the book, and that's where I really learned his skills as a teacher, because he read the manuscript, and he said, well, I've got a couple of comments about the end, and also the villain's name, who is called Amadeo, and I can't remember what I named him, but he said, you need a really sharp Italian name, like Scarpello, which means scalpel. So I said, God, that's really great. And he said, and then let's look at the ending. And in the ending, the heroine of the novel dies, and the protagonist goes to tell Scarpello, who she'd been involved with before the protagonist had fallen in love with her. And he goes up to the club where Scarpello owns, and Scarpello's in the door. And he said, Nicole is dead, Scarpello. She died an hour ago at Boussico, and I am leaving Paris. And as I turned to go to the taxi, I saw his face, old and green under the light, as he turned to the door of the club. And then I went on and on with this romantic bullshit. And just, you know, terrible, terrible writing. Harold said, Tommy, this is your ending. Old and green as he turned to the, and he was absolutely right. And he just had such a sharp vision of what something could be. And he never, you know, imposed his own words or anything. It was, he was working with your stuff and making it so much better. He was a born editor. As well as a great poet. But, as luck would have it, his birthday was on the 16th of July. Mine was on the 18th. And we went into Nice, and here was this really handsome young guy sitting at this table alone in a cafe. Harold said, "Stop the car. Go park it. I've got to get out right now." So I park the car, and I come back, and Harold just has this guy mesmerized, talking to him at the table. And Harold said, "We got to go." His name was Neil. He said, "We have to take," and he was a train worker. He worked in the French National Railroad. He said, "We have to take Lyon back to the cabin." And I said, "Harold, we've got to really be careful, okay? Because I've seen what happens when you fuck the counters over, and it's not pleasant." And he said, "We'll be okay, we'll be okay." So I swear we smuggled him in, okay? We parked a little in a different place and kind of ducked down, went down to the cabin. And Harold had his great night with Leon. And then we stuck at 5:30 in the morning, and in France, everything is, you know, in the summer, it doesn't get dark until 10 or 11, and it starts to get light again around 4:30 because it's so much farther north than we are. We smuggled him out the side, and he was going through the bushes and everything. And we said, "We did it. We got it done." About 10 o'clock, I was summoned to the Mons. She said, "Thomas, did I tell you no panky panky?" I said, "Yes, Countess." She said, "Harold will be out of here by noon." So, Harold was out of there by noon. And I was out of there shortly after, but not for the same reason. My time had come up. Christine had come down from Paris, and we were headed to Portugal. And Harold was headed to Greece. And I was waiting, I had to wait about 2 days after I left the Mons, because I had to get a French driver's license. And in France, the examiner comes around from village to village. So I was going to have my third test, having flunked the first two. Not as a driver, but on the written. And so Christine and I were down on the beach, and we looked down the beach, and all of a sudden, here comes Harold up the beach. And we thought, you know, he was been gone for a week to Greece. We said, "Harold, what are you doing here?" And he said, "Oh, you know, I've had some good luck." And so I've had this wonderful boyfriend, but now it's time to go to Greece. So we stood on the beach and chatted for a while, and that's the last time we saw Harold until 1968. But Harold wanted to do some readings in America, and we started this long correspondence because I volunteered to see if I could get him the readings at American colleges and universities. And the correspondence was perhaps 70 to 80 letters over a four-year period. It was difficult because Harold would constantly change his mind about when he wanted to do the readings, which occasioned a few, or quite a few, second letters to the heads of the writing departments. "Whoops, Mr. Norse's availability has changed. I do hope you haven't scheduled anything." And so, as a result, we never did get that scheduled because he never could get organized. I'd like to conclude these memories by reading a few short paragraphs from the letters that will hopefully give you some precise visions of Harold in different situations. And the first one is from Greece, from Athens. "Did I tell you that Henry Miller and Lawrence Durrell are expected here any day now? If I can just put off my stable of boys for a few minutes, I'll be able to have a chat with them. But this country has to be lived in to be believed. I get winked at, hissed at, clucked at, smiled at, groped everywhere I go. It isn't safe in the streets for a decent man like me. Two nights ago, I was followed for nearly a half hour by three great big boys and finally cornered. They were sure I was a Greek, pretending not to be, but I somehow talked my way out of it, or I'd have been raped right there and then and there on a dark street. Tonight, I'm entertaining four very nice Greek students who tell me they would like to come over with a few dozen more. Since I've already had three of them, I know they're safe. I just tell the leader whom I want and whom I don't, and then go to it. All this without the intrusion of money. See what I mean? I'm thinking of a little trip to that Turkish village where 5 out of 7 rapes are of men, although the Turks have the reputation of being primitive. But that's what I like. I'm primitive myself. You're so right. As long as I keep my pecker up, my health is down. I've laid off for 3 days and I'm a new baby. But it's hard. They come banging at my door at all hours. The Greek are pretty nice, are pretty sweet guys though, no trouble. Best in the world. I've had so many pricks here, I'm thinking of Kant. By the law of diminishing returns. And seriously, I'd even like to get married. You're thinking I'm crazy. Yeah, of course. But actually, the greatest part of American or Northern homosexuality is made up of frustrations. And when that goes, you can relax and really know what you want. Anyway, it has come to this, more or less. Now I'm a full-fledged Mediterranean. I understand why they marry. Because they can always have boys on the side. And then this is the first time he's mentioned Bukowski to me. This is still from Greece. There's a great new poet in Los Angeles called Chaz Bukowski, whose new book, It Catches My Heart in Its Hands, from a line of Jeffers, has got tremendous ovation from those who know. And the printing job is so fabulously far out, lush, and rich dish of bookmaking, that quims and assholes are quivering from ecstasy from coast to coast. I entered into correspondence with this guy. We had corresponded when I was in Paris. He's a guy featured in the issue of The Outsider that I'm in. And we dig each other. And he's sort of a disciplined Hemingway in verse. And he's tough and gentle and funny and has real narrative power and lyric inventiveness worth more natural style and colloquial speech than anybody writing poetry today. Shame that he became John Bryant said of Bukowski, he was a great, great poet, but a lousy human being. And finally, I'd like to end with something that I think will get across to you, the Harold that I really knew and loved, when he was positive, when he felt the world was finally coming into focus for him, and that everything was going to go great. According to astral signs, horoscopes, etc., we are going to come into our own next year, provided we don't get drowned by past hurts and humiliations, quit nursing old grievances, and keep on the stick. I've been through such absolute grinding, infernal death throes for 2 years that I can't talk about it. But the cycle is now coming in where our work will be recognized. If your novel is as great as that section that was published, I see no reason why it shouldn't be, since the discipline is there, the language, the weeding out of exaggerated, inflated rhetoric, a danger with cancerians, the sentimentality gone, then you're up there, man. I'm proud of you, proud that I may have had a finger in the pie early on. We've got to stick together now. The beats have had their say. We are going to push them aside towards a new direction that I see now will be finally through with reaction and present art as pure action and no axe to grind. art as done by human beings with a sense of humanity, but without posturing or faking or public address systems. We won't mind publicity, but don't go out of our way for the corrupt bastards. Keep the cool, baby. Don't despair. Book and I will be in a position to make your novel known and widely appreciated. Only hope he doesn't drop dead because he's down in the skids all the way. Hemorrhaging again, drinking, smoking fat cigars, dying. Keep me on. Send me books, magazines, newspapers. But if you're broke, send me only letters. No more sob stuff. That's how we're grown up now. Book is fire, Aries. Leo, Lion, and we are sensitive but tough Cancerians. Love you both. Harold. Thank you.